Hey everyone, I'm going to be doing another review today. Today is something a little different. I'm going to be doing a review of actually a couple of different lightsabers in one shot. Some hero styled Luke Return of the Jedi. The first one is my Vader's Vault Luke hero. And my other is my Saberforge Prodigal Son. I've done unboxing of both of these lightsabers, but I've never actually done reviews of either one. And also for some fun, I broke out my old Master Replicas FX lightsabers. This was the first generation 2003, I think EL blade is what they call it. And the second one was the 2005, the second generation, which actually had the string blade. I'll light those up in a little bit, but I just figured I'd break them out just for size comparison. So first up is my Vader's Vault hero. I really enjoyed getting this. This I purchased on the first run back on May 4th, and you know, it took a long time to obviously get to me, but that's fine. I had no problem waiting for this. This actually came out great. I was very happy with this. The quality is fantastic. It's my first Vader's Vault lightsaber. I love the crystal shard soundboard in here, the 2-up bass speaker. This lightsaber is very, very loud. The accuracy that went into this hilt, the copper neck, the lit up LEDs in here. I just love everything that they did about this. I went for the emitter delete. I'm not really going to be dealing with this saber anyway, but the fact that it had that large piece that was coming out here, that just wasn't for me. I wanted something to be as movie accurate as possible, so the fact that I have a removable blade plug that replicates the nipple on top, I'm very happy with that. That's fine. I did end up getting both the standard and the photon, but I do love the fact that they have the LED inside the emitter here, which I will expand upon when I start talking about the Prodigal Son. But the ease of access to get to the chassis, okay, the fact that they put a recharge port in here. Now, I know Vader's Vault doesn't do recharge ports traditionally. This is my only Vader's Vault, so I really have no other comparison other than this, other than things I've read. I wouldn't mind seeing Vader's Vault actually have that as an option. I know most of their stuff, it's just they have the batteries that you swap in and out. I see people sometimes have trouble with those batteries. That's something that I read about often. If they had an option when you're purchasing it to either do a recharge port or not, I feel like that would benefit them and benefit the customers a lot more. For me, I'm not really doing a lot of battery swapping. I'd rather just have a recharge port and charge it up. But then again, I'm not doing a lot of dueling with it. I understand for the batteries, it's for people that do a lot of dueling. They can swap the batteries in and out if they're at a show or something like that. So, you know, I can understand that. But at least, you know, give maybe us, the customers, an option to actually do that. I'm sure it would charge a couple extra dollars to put a recharge port in, but I'm sure the people that want it would be willing to actually go with that. So I'm just going to remove the kill key.
I see you have constructed a new lightsaber.
Like I said, very, very loud. I'm going to turn all these on in a little bit, but I just wanted to just kind of go over some of the looks of the sabers first. I love the real copper neck in here and the real copper box. I think that those are great additions to the saber. I know that there are other ones that are coming out now and ones that have been done in the past. I think one replicas and all that have done copper before, but I know that this is one of the more movie accurate sabers to what we actually see on screen. So I really appreciate the level of detail that they tried going to with this. Okay, so now for my Prodigal Son. This is the heroed tiered Prodigal Son. So it has not only the primary activation in here, but it also has an auxiliary switch, which as you can see is on the back side here. This is a painted copper here. This is not a real copper, as well as these rails in here. Now, when this came to me, this actually had the black Greeblies. It had that on the bottom when you get a Prodigal Son. This actually happened to fall off within the first, I think, 2 or 3 days that I had it. I was outside swinging around, and it just popped off with my hand. So You know, a little frustrating just getting something like that and it popped right off. It didn't seem like there was a lot of glue or anything holding it down. So I sanded it, put a little E6000 on there, and I moved it up to where it's supposed to be. So that actually, to me, just looks a little bit better because of a little more movie accurate. I heard a lot of complaints about the card sliding. And I have to say, mine really is held in pretty well. I have not done any customization to this at all. But I mean, I can move it around upside down. I've swung it a lot and this has not slid out at all. So again, I purchased this in February of 2016 and I received it in May. So I know that they were going through some changes. That could have been one of them because there were a lot of complaints before I actually received mine. So when they started to build it, they might have made some changes to fix that. There were a couple things I'd make suggestions on with this. Everyone knows that the Prodigal Son's LED is in here. It's actually in the upper section of the grenade section in here. So that means that light has to travel through these small little tubes before it actually comes out through the emitter. Okay, and you can see here the nipple is drilled through so that the LED is deep within there. I still think it gives off decent amount of light. Whatever they're doing, it does help. However, with companies like KR Sabers, with Vader's Vault, One Replicas, even Solo's Hold with their V2, there are ways to make sure that the emitter can hold the LED. So to me, I feel like Saberforge should make a couple of modifications to the Prodigal Son and even to the Redeemer, the other thin neck, to make sure that they can house that LED inside the emitter. And I think that that would benefit them, and also the customers would enjoy that a lot more because obviously it would be a brighter saber and a brighter blade. Some of the other modifications, I really don't, it's okay that it's painted, you know, it's not like they're, you know, they could make this real copper if they really wanted to, but I understand how much copper costs, so it's gonna make the saber cost a little bit more. What I would actually think that they should do, I believe Saberforge now has a legacy tier saber, so they have their elite tiers, and I think now there's even a legacy edition, which there are two sabers in there right now that cost a little bit more. You could do that with the thin necks. I mean, if you're going to make those modifications to house that in here, I think that people would be willing to pay a little bit extra as long as the saber is going to be brighter and it's going to be a little bit more sturdy. I did have to send my saber in for an RMA because of a loose emitter after the first time I did actually duel with it. The neck itself was fine. There was nothing in here that came loose. I know I've seen some broken thin necks out there, a lot of repetitive pictures that are going around. Again, I think that some of those were some older pictures. The ones that mine has, I think was one of their redesigns. But I think also one of the benefits is if they did house the LED inside the emitter, they could actually make the neck stronger. Okay, they can thicken that part up so it's not as wide. So all you got to do, all the wires are going through there instead and not light that has to shine through. So I think that's another benefit. You'd probably have less RMAs for broken thin necks. The other thing that I would really like to see is for them to fix these two painted on triangles. I'm sorry if this sounds bad, but it just seems a little cheap. I would have rather you just given me some like red and green acrylic arrows just kind of glued in there rather than just these painted on. Something to be a little bit more realistic. I think you can kind of redesign this box and make that happen. Not only that, get rid of the second AV switch underneath here. I would, again, there are many companies out there that are putting the switches that can fit both inside the box. I see no reason why Saberforge can't do the same exact thing. I would really like to see that happen on future Prodigal Sons. The other thing I would like to see changed, Saberforge is such a big company. Why they're not using chassis is beyond me at this point in time. The fact that they're taping the soundboard to the battery with electrical tape, I mean, it doesn't really move, which is fine, but the fact that there's always a chance for something to dislodge or hit. Wires can come loose. I think you're much better off at this point in time. Get a 3D printing machine and design your own chassis. Again, it's something that, yes, it might add to the cost of the Saber, but I think people will be willing to pay for it. It would keep the electronics, in my eyes, a lot more, it would keep them more intact, less chance of something getting loose or breaking off. And to me, that makes it well worth it. So if you're going to charge a little bit extra because you're printing out a 3D plastic chassis in here, do it. It's well worth it in my eyes, and I'm sure a lot of other people that would be willing to spend the extra money on it. But going back to this, if you can make this a legacy to your Saber, make some modifications to this to make it a stronger thin neck. Remove secondary AV switches, hide everything inside the control box. To me, that would make it a much better Saber, more accurate. I know some people don't care about accuracy, they just care about the strength of dueling. I kind of like the best of both worlds, if possible. To not have this nipple here, not that hard to have a custom blade plug, guys. You could easily have this go inside, and again, you could do the same thing for a Redeemer, have a custom blade plug that sits inside the emitter, and I think your fans would absolutely love that. So, those are kind of my thoughts on everything, as far as the two sabers. This was the first FX saber that, or dueling FX saber that I purchased. Once I kind of got back into the hobby, I've had the Master Replicas FX sabers for a long time. Obviously, these are just really pretty much for show. But after the Force Awakens last year, there was obviously the big craze, and this was one of the first ones that I ended up seeing online. And it was so close to Luke's Return of the Jedi, which happens to be my favorite saber. That's one of the reasons why I ended up purchasing it. And again, I was very happy when I received this, and I'm still happy with it. It's something that I will, you know, enjoy, I will use. I'm not nervous to use it at all. If something does go wrong, I have the skills that I can actually fix it myself. So again, I'm not too worried about that. I would just love to see some more modifications to make it a little bit more sturdy, to make it a little bit brighter and a little bit more movie accurate. That's more or less my thing. Again, this to me is more of a big showpiece that I probably won't ever really duel with this. I don't want to ever take the chance of something. Not that anything would happen to it. I mean, I know the quality and the build are fantastic, but I don't want to nick any of this up if there's a stray hit or anything like that. But it was, I think when they announced that these were happening, obviously I had already purchased this, and there was nothing really I could do about it, so of course I just went ahead and purchased this one also. But that's how much I love the Luke Hero. I mean, I feel like you probably can't have enough, although my wife might say differently. I really enjoyed these sabers, and it's something that I will definitely hold on to for quite a long time. Alright, so with all that, let me get the kill key out of this guy.
I am a Jedi. Like my father before me.
I figure I would just do a little comparison, just for fun, on the actual brightness of some of these blades. Now, both of these are, they're fully charged. The only thing is these are obviously different blades. This is a 36-inch Vader's Vault standard. And this is Saberforge's V4. It's also their thin neck blade. So I'm just going to dim the lights just to get a little bit more of an effect. This way hopefully we can get a good idea. First, just for fun, let me just shine on the Master Replicas. Okay, so here's the 2003 EL. Okay. Here's 2005's LED. There you can see the stream blade lighting up. and the two color greens are very different. The 2003 is much more of a mint green. The 2005 is more of your standard green. The Vader's Vault.
I see you have constructed a new lightsaber.
Okay, and again, fantastic light up LEDs. Really love that. This is, of course, more of your standard green. This looks much more like your 2005 Master Replicas color. And as you can just see in the video, it is outshining it quite a bit. And now for Saberforge.
Where's this going?
My secondary AV switch is green. That was something I did request, and they did come through with, so I was very happy about that. Again, I'm just going to put this one here. I mean, out of the four of these, the Vader's Vault one is by far the brighter of the four. I mean, at this point, the Prodigal Son is slightly brighter than the Master Replicas, and again, I just have a feeling that's because of where the LED is housed. I mean, just look. If you can see on screen here, okay, this is Vader's Vault, and here's Saberforge here, the Prodigal Son. So to me, big difference with that LED and where it's housed. I would really like to see Saberforge change that. But I don't work for the company, so not my call. But I would like to see that happen. Let me get these guys, let me turn these off. So that's just my review of everything here. I just wanted to kind of show off all four of them just so you could see what they look like. My thoughts still on the Saberforge Saber. I had a really good experience with the customer service. I just want that to be known. So even though I did have to send this in for an RMA, they were very responsive. They were very quick to answer my emails, to help me through the whole process. And it probably took me about 2 weeks to send it back and then receive it again. So I just want that to be known out there. My experience with them has actually been positive, unlike some others that I've read. You know, I can only tell you and let you know what I have experienced. I can't really let you know about anybody else's other than what I've read online. So I had a great experience with the Vader's Vault, other than the long wait, which is standard, nothing to really do about that. This right now is definitely my favorite hero saber out of the ones that I have. Definitely more of a shelf queen though, not much dueling. Like I said, I'm gonna be using that for. It's gonna go up probably with my Sabers Hold V2 and my Grandflex 2.1 that I've built. I'm probably gonna be doing reviews on those shortly as well. Those are two that I personally built, so I have my own thoughts on that. That I'll get out there and share with everybody. But overall, you know, I love the Luke Hero. And usually whenever I see it, I'm always into it. I have, you know, both Master Replicas versions that they have, the Elite Edition and then the Standard Edition, which is one of the first ones that did come out. With the movie that's coming out in December, I'm sure there's gonna be others that are out there. I would actually love to build my own. I know KR Sabers has theirs that's out there right now. I'm probably going to wait and hold on it because I want to see what happens with episode 8. I'm sure the saber's going to change slightly like they've done in every single movie. And when they do, whoever puts that out as an empty, I'll probably look to purchase that so I can actually put it together myself. Alright? But thanks a lot guys for watching. You know, any questions or comments, just write them down below. And yeah, this was a lot of fun. Alright? I love doing comparisons. And again, especially my favorite saber, I couldn't resist. All right, thanks a lot, guys. Take care. Oh, I have to make a little addendum. I forgot one last little thing. The soundboards. So Obviously, the Vader's Vault has the Crystal Shard 3.0. The Saberforge has the NEC Spark Color 2. I've actually had a Saberforge Champion Edition that had the Saber Core, the Viridian, and then there's also the Crimson. Those two soundboards do not compare even to the Spark Color 2. When I ignited this for the first time, hearing a Spark Color 2 compared to Saberforge's Viridian was a world of a difference. It was night and day. It's such a better board than their Viridians and their Crimsons. The Viridian and the Crimson are real, I guess, basic if you want to say, but the Spark Color 2 was much, much better. And I love the Crystal Shard. It's a great board as well. A lot of different fun options on there. Obviously, Vader's Vault does their own customization of it, but I know it's very similar to like a Prism. Speaking of colors, this was a green, green, white, so very, very straightforward. This was the RGBA in there, so I can change colors. I think that's also one of the reasons as well. Well, it's not as bright as there's not multiple greens going through there. It's just one of the green dye. That would also probably change things if it was fully green. But to be honest, I did also have a crystal reveal of the Prodigal Son, which was all green. And even with that, it really was barely brighter than just this one that was in the RGBA. I have comparison photos up that I can show as well. But I think the Spark Color 2 is a great board. The NEC versus Plector, I know people will talk about how the Crystal Focus is probably the best board out there, and it probably is. I have not worked with the Igniter yet, but the people that do, they love that board. I've worked with Spark 2 quite a bit. I have not worked with a Nano Biscotti, so I can't really say much, but I do like what the Spark 2 offers over the Nano Biscotti. So typically on some of my more basic installs, I've used a Spark 2 instead of that. Even though most of the fonts out there on Saber Font are more for Plector than they are for NEC. But I did have to make that comment on the boards that the NEC Spark Color 2 is ahead of Saberforge's basic Viridian and Crimson. That's another thing that they could look into. I mean, I don't know if they want to try and make a deal with NEC and start using Spark 2s in their Champion Editions. This way, the Champion Editions could actually get a Flash on Clash. You can do multiple sound fonts. And they can do their heroes still at the Spark Color 2 level, where this way they could have the RGBA, the changing color for the LED. There's a ton of options out there, a ton of ways that I think Saberforge could probably improve upon that, especially with the way they have their tiers lined up, and as well as they're having their Apprentice, Elite, and Legacy, and Crystal Reveal Sabers. So just some thoughts out there that I had that I wanted to kind of share. But yeah, that's the only thing I just wanted to add to this. All right. So again, thanks again for watching, everyone.